The resveratrol field, when I first was following it back in, I guess, the early 2000s, I was very skeptical that there would be any effect in humans taking resveratrol, because certainly not from drinking a glass of wine, but from supplementing, just because it seemed as though like the doses required to get some really beneficial effects, at least in some of the rodent studies, seemed sort of, high, and it didn't seem very attainable. But as you know, there was a really sort of compelling primate study in rhesus monkeys. I forgot when that was published. It was like mid-2000s or 2011 or something like
Right,
that.
Ruffo DiCarbo's group at NIH.
Yes, that's right. They gave these rhesus monkeys resveratrol, and I think they started out with a lower dose, like 80 milligrams per kilogram, and they went up to like 480. Any reason? Do you know why they start with? I've seen more than one study do that.
Just anecdotally, what Ruffo told me, I think, is that they started at the low dose and didn't see a change in pulse wave velocity in the blood vessels, so they upped it, and then that's where they saw the benefit.
Oh, okay. So, well, this study was, the doses were very doable in humans when you convert. And basically they, feeding these monkeys, they were feeding them like this terrible high sucrose diet, high sucrose and high fat, and they like it caused them to have like 40% increased aortic stiffness. But the resveratrol completely ameliorated it. Like, so I was like, holy crap, that's pretty cool. I think that was the one study that sort of changed my view. And then I started to sort of get into the literature and read more, and there's been a variety of clinical studies, as you know, and
Well, I'm glad somebody's reading the literature. Because there was a hate me club with resveratrol, because it got so much attention. Anything that gets a lot of attention gets the hate me club, in reverse.